Hello folks, so what I want to do in this video is to expose you to this very key choice that device engineers around the world are struggling to make. That is whether they make their FinFETs on a SOI substrate as shown over here, or they make them on a bulk substrate as shown over here. And there are pros and cons of taking either of the approach. So as I described to you in one of the videos earlier, the way you make FinFET or the way you define fins in your SOI substrate is that you have a fixed thickness of your silicon, and then you essentially etch that to describe your fin, and so that way you get your fin height is determined by your silicon thickness to start with, and you get these fins which have a very uniform fin height, or in other words their variation in their fin height is pretty low. As compared to in a bulk substrate, the way you define your fins is you etch these tall fins first, you fill this up with an oxide, and then you recess that oxide back to expose your fin. So this introduces a larger variability in the height of your fins. So that's one disadvantage of making fins using a bulk substrate. But on the other hand, if you're looking from an economics point of view, bulk substrates are cheaper as and always SOI substrate are more expensive. So in fact, a lot of initial work on FinFETs was in fact done on SOI substrate. So shown here is this very first paper on FinFET or fully depleted devices from Hisamoto-san in 1990, and he essentially he used this SOI substrate with this oxide layer, and he patterned the silicon on top into this shape of the fin. And a lot of initial work in Berkeley on FinFETs as well was all done on this SOI substrate, because it's easier to define and control your fins here. Also, most of the university labs, they don't at that time didn't used to have any STI process. On the other hand, we saw this Intel announcement where they did use a bulk substrate, and they used to define these tall fins, and then you recess your oxide back to expose your fin to the required fin height. So there are both approaches which are, you know, which were toyed around with. And so coming back to our pro and con table, because we need to clearly make a choice over here. So listing out some of the other arguments, one argument one can say is that, you know, when you operate your FinFETs, you will generate some heat. So there'll be heat, you know, there'll be heat which will be generated in your FinFET transistor as you keep on operating it, especially if you make a microprocessor and operate at a very high frequency. So one of the advantage of being in a bulk substrate is that silicon is a decent conductor of heat, and you can easily dissipate your heat into your substrate. On the other hand, if you are making your FinFET on a SOI substrate, oxide has a thermal conductivity which is 100 times of the thermal conductivity of silicon. So the thermal conductivity of oxide is, you know, 2 orders of magnitude lower than silicon. So it becomes pretty hard. The only way the heat can flow out is through through these gate and through these contacts, but it's harder from a heat perspective over here. So clearly SOI substrate, one of the problem is heat dissipation. On the other hand, the bulk FinFETs can be, you know, pretty cool about it and dissipate the heat very neatly. So let's come back to this pros and cons table over here. So what I see is bulk is starting to look good. It's cheaper, it's cooler. So let me try to balance this out by highlighting one of the disadvantages that you get with a bulk technology. That is, you get something which is known as a parasitic BJT. So let me describe that using this cartoon. So what is this parasitic BJT? So as we discussed earlier, so you have in a FinFET device your gate wrapping around your fin, and it does a pretty good job of controlling the current in this fin, but there's life underneath, especially if you are making your FinFET on a SOI substrate. So there's silicon fin which is underneath this source drain region. So as you can see over here, there's a silicon fin which is underneath, and this drain over here can still talk to my source using this silicon fin. And if I look at the dopings over here, so this is assuming, say, it's N MOSFET. I have N plus source and drain, and I have this P silicon fin. So what I have is essentially a parasitic BJT, and what I have essentially is this BJT, which is this NPN BJT, which is in parallel with my silicon FinFET above. So this is a big problem, and it has always been a problem for bulk technology that you get this parasitic BJT below your actual MOSFET device. And the way people try to mitigate its effect is by, in this FinFET device, is by doping this region below the fin, below your channel, by a very high doping. So what they try to do is increase the doping over here, and that helps in removing this parasitic current or improving your IOF. So you can see in this chart over here that this is for an NFET device, and as people are increasing that doping in this region from 1E16 to 1E17 all the way up to 2E18, you see that as you are increasing the doping, your IOF is decreasing, and that is typically achieved using this implant in this region, which is also known as a channel stop implant. But it adds to the process complexity, so you need to dope your fin region below your channel, and you really don't want to, you know, add that extra process complexity. So I would say this is an argument which is against my bulk substrate. As compared to a SOI substrate, I essentially have no life underneath my fin, so underneath my fin is just my oxide, so it has no issue of parasitic BJT. Finally, I want to end with this one last thing, and that goes against my friend SOI MOSFET, which so far hasn't gone into production. That is, you have this problem of doing source and drain epitaxy in a SOI kind of FinFET device. So I want to explain that using this cartoon over here. So given are these fins on a SOI and a bulk substrate, and when I'm doing a source drain epitaxy, what I do for making this source drain, and we'll discuss this more later, if I want to have more strain in my source drain, what I do is I etch what I do is I etch this silicon fin in the soil drain region, and then I grow my soil drain from this silicon below, and I grow it in a fashion like this. So I grow my soil drain after I do etch back. And I can do in this process flow over here because I have my silicon channel available here. So I can regrow my soil drain using my silicon or my bulk as a template. On the other hand, if I come to this SOI substrate and I etch off this fin in the soil drain region, there's nothing left below from which I can grow. So I can't grow my soil drain region over here because there's no template available for growing this crystalline region back. So that's another limitations of SOI flow. So hopefully, you know, I've highlighted some of these pros and cons, and it's still not clear which is a winner, and only that's something that only our friend time can tell us eventually which wins out.